Hey guys, so today we are talking about the Warlock class. So if you are wanting to do a ton of DPS through dot damage mainly, summons, and even have some pretty good survivability on your own without needing the healer's help too much, the Warlock is the class for you. And I think now we're getting into the DPS classes. This is my first guide on DPS. And I think that there is a lot more variety and like different play styles between the DPS classes compared to the healer and tank classes, right? So this should be a little bit more like if you're watching all the videos for some reason, this one should feel a little bit different because I'm not like copying what I said between the tanks or the healers. So yeah, let's go over a quick overview of the class. I think Warlock might be one of the most popular DPS classes, seeing as most of the top players on every server has a Warlock on their team. I think a lot of that is because I'm not sure, but I think it has to do because maybe on the Chinese server or Taiwanese server they had a really like their strongest player was a Warlock and things like that. So people are probably like, "Oh, that must be the best class," so everyone played it again. And I think they are very strong. I do think they're probably top two DPS for sure. So, a safe pick if you're gonna play DPS. But let's go ahead and talk about the style of play. So, like I mentioned earlier, you can do damage over time build, and you can do a like summon build, which is based around these frogs. So, if that's interesting to you. I do think that if you really want to get into summons, then Hunter will be the better class for just straight summoning things. But the Warlock does have a piece of that, so that is cool too. Let's go ahead and talk about the attributes. So attributes are simple. It's full intellect, then secondary into tech. This is going to be the same for every single DPS class. Intellect gives you damage, tech gives you crit. You need both of those for DPS, and it's like super simple. We get a symbiosis and assist pet or talent here, which assist is great, symbiosis is whatever. And let's go. That was quick. I mean, there's really I can't, like in my other videos, I mentioned, oh, this might be better to get some stamina here, or might be better to do more tech here. This is straight up. It's always going to be better to go full attack and full tech, or and then secondary tech after that. So we're gonna move on to the pets. All right, Basic has a lot of legendary pets. So pets is also pretty easy because you're going to want an attack or an assist pet. I personally think assist pet's going to be better because it scales stronger, but attack is not bad either. And what I mean by assist and attack is you see this little icon in the top here, top right of each pet. This is an attack, like primary stat is attack, and this is a primary assist. So you're looking for red or blue in the top right corner there. So he actually has some good legendaries for attack, especially you can see here. So early on, your strongest pet is going to be probably something with attack. So this guy is really good, but that's in Kobo Coast. So you're probably looking more at like rain this guy at Rainforest. Even earlier than that, I see a lot of people run the Saber Tiger. That's a good one. But let's go ahead and talk about like the main pet everyone's gonna probably use at end game, and that's going to be, let's see if we can find him here, this guy right here, the Tyrant Dragon. So Tyrant Dragon is an attack pet. It has 10 fire, which is gonna be really strong against the lightning pets. You'll see your 10 against lightning pets. So I do recommend if you're going to like spam feast or certain type of feast for a pet that you spam the let me double check. You spam the Matchless Chieftain feast. I think that gives you quite a few options for attack pets. Here. Oh, there it is. Yep, it gives you the Saber Tiger King, which is also a great attack pet, and the Tyrant Dragon. So this is a good one for you to spam once you get there. It is a little later in the game. Probably takes you about 10 days to get there, minimum. So that's pet, and let's go to pet skills. Because you're going to be good on pet. For DPS, specifically for DPS, this is different from healer and tank, right? Specifically for DPS, I think that attribute matters the most. Like, you want an attack pet or an assist pet. But even more important than that, you need to follow the attributes. So look to follow this like counter element. This counter element. I mean, element is the most important part, right? So if you're fighting a lightning pet, get a fire pet. If you're fighting or a lightning monster, if you're fighting an earth monster, get a lightning pet. So that's going to be the most important. It makes a big difference, guys, for sure. I've actually been like 20% away from killing a boss. I go through, change everyone's pet. That's it. Skills stayed the same and beat the boss easily. So this it, the element makes a big difference. So let's talk about skills. Pet skills, actually very simple. Inspire. Inspire is like the most important skill for DPS to have. I don't think there's any argument for anything being as close to as good as Inspire. So you have to get this. If like for whatever case like here he doesn't have it, then I would really look into the probably Rend or Smash. Let's go through passive skills. You have to get inspired, guys. So for passive skills, you want photosynthesis as usual. I think it's best in slot for every person or every class. But out, like I said, outside of photosynthesis, which just gives you energy, which is really good, you can do things like competitive heart. It's going to be really good for an assist pet, and battle heart. Those will be my two second ones. So we've done pet skills. Let's go to the regular skills. And this is most of my video is usually covering this section here on class skills. So there early on, you're going to unlock Painful Ignition. I think it's one of the first spells that you unlock right here. Yep. Painful Ignition is going to carry you through the early game really hard because it's got really good scaling numbers. The thing is, it's just straight damage. And the reason you're using Painful Ignition early is because you don't have any form of combo early on, right? Like, you only have damage spells and healing spells. That's about it. Like, single target, multi-target, damage over time. But there's no, like, combo or there's no, like, chain of abilities that work together well early on. So this is going to be your strongest skill early, Painful Ignition. So use that. After Painful Ignition gets kind of like you get farther into the stages, almost everyone I see is running the Soul Seal build. What the Soul Seal build does is basically put a damage over time like a dot on the enemy when you first cast Soul Seal. So it applies the Soul Seal and it does 7.1% damage over 2 seconds. This obviously changes based on skill level. For 24 seconds. When the target dies, the seals will be passed on to the nearby enemy. It's only stacks 10 times, so it's a little different than the assassin that can stack 15, but it's still really strong. And the fact that it dies means for like the tiger bosses, it's really good. Trying to think. Even for like some of the AoE bosses where it has like three enemies, those you can still use Soul Seal. I wouldn't, but if it's the only high tier skills that you have, then it's still good there. And the combo is always going to be Soul Seal first, because you need to get start stacking as soon as you can. Then something with a 3 cost. So early on, you're not going to have Soul Sash, Soul Lash, and you're going to be using Painful Ignition like this, right? But eventually, it's much better to have Soul Lash somewhere in your rotation, right? And then third, we always see Soul Wave, and the reason is it resets the effective duration of Soul Seal. So you know how this has a time limit of like 24 seconds or something, this is going to refresh that, and so you kind of have one skill in between every refresh of Soul Seal, which is good. And I think that Soul Wave is actually good value for damage. It is 253% of the damage and also gives is only cost a 2 energy cost. So it lets you cycle through your skills really fast as a warlock. And then the last one, in this case, we're using Painful Ignition because this is a single target fight. But I've been seeing this... I've been seeing this really common build, which is the Violent Frog. It scales off of your attack. I would recommend if you're paired up with a warrior or a gladiator and they use Call to Arms or Let's Charge, I would probably, if you're not going to get it on the Soul Seal cast, which is the first one, the frog one is really good too, because this scales off of your attack, right? So this frog is going to last for 14 seconds and do constant damage. And I do think that the main appeal to the warlock is damage over time. You'll notice a lot of the skills outside of Painful Ignition and Soul Lash are overtime effects. Soul Seal is overtime, Violent Frog is overtime. So you'll see that like over the course of a fight, they gradually get stronger. Whereas something like maybe a mage or a hunter will start off with just more damage. And it's not that they fall off, it's just that they don't scale higher throughout the fight. So these five skills that I've mentioned now, early game and then mid game are going to be like the most common ones that you use. The two exceptions to that are going to be Quack, which is your silence. You can use this. This is a 3-second silence. That is really good. You can use it before he casts the skill. Stop, like, delays the skill cast for a while. During it is obviously ideal, but you have a lot of leeway with Quack to be able to like stop a skill from being cast. So you're going to use this a lot. Every class is going to use their interrupt a lot, but I feel like the warlock one is really good. The next one I want to make, there is a frog build that you can go. I honestly don't think it's, I think it's not used that much. I haven't seen a reason to use it, especially because Elder Frog is for AoE. So you will use Elder Frog for sure, but only in AoE fights, right? So I wouldn't recommend in single target rotation using that. And I don't think Warlock really excels in AoE as much as, say, like a mage does. But they do have things that they can do for that. And Frog Synergy and Elder Frog are going to be your two main AoE skills. So you're going to cast... Let me go ahead and just make it for you guys real quick so you can see. It's going to be, where'd it go? Oh, here it is. You're looking at something similar to those three skills. And your last one's kind of, Incinerate's probably a good one. You're going to summon the frog. You're going to multi-ignition. You're going to extend frog synergy. Then you're going to incinerate. And this is your AoE build. It's really strong. Has quick turnover too. There's no like 4-cost skills. So that's AoE. And now let's move on to what I think the late game or end game build, and I think the most the most interesting skill that a warlock has, and that is, oh hold on, I'm not like super familiar with the pictures, because when I first learned them, it was just through text. Here. Soul Twins is going to be used. What's the next one? Oh. No. There it is. Life Tap. So these two skills, I think, are going to get used more towards the end game. I think that Soul Twins is going to add on to your combo. Let me go ahead and make the combo again so you guys kind of see what it looks like. By the way, like, you'll notice my... healing guide and tank guides, the skills won't, sections aren't going to be as long as the DPS ones. DPS have a lot of, you'll notice all the DPS have a ton of legendary skills. That's because they can't really just pick 4 skills. And that's why I say that if you're going to be if you have a team of 4 and you're all 4 friends, and you're like, hey, I'm probably going to spend like $20, and this other guy's like, I'm going to spend $100 or something, then like the $100 guy should play a DPS. I think they require more money to be like as effective. I totally forgot where I was. I already got Soul Seal. Soul Seal, Soul Twins, Life Tap, and I want the refresh. Okay, so you're gonna look at this. Something similar to this. So Life Tap, I think, is the defining skill for the Warlock. I really think it if you're like if you are deciding between all the DPS classes and you're like, which one do I pick? Like, they all seem so similar, or they like I just can't I don't have a favorite one or whatever. Like, if Life Tap sounds cool to you, then this is, I feel like, the only class in the game that has this skill. It's their defining skill. So you sacrifice 30% of your HP to instantly restore 3 points of energy. If the sacrifice H or the sacrifice HP will be returned to the Warlock over 12 seconds, so like half of it, and it's gonna go up. Like, you can almost return all of it. I think that you to use this skill, you have to. It has a huge upside, but it has potential bad. Like, you need to work with your team before you use this skill. Like, you really need to go through everyone's skills. You need to watch the fight, see what order happens. Because if you eat up a heal that is supposed to be for your tank because of this skill, you've probably just lost the fight for your team. Because the tank's gonna die, then you get one shot anyway. So you make sure you use this either just watch the fight so you'll know when to use it. Like, don't put this in at the if there's like a big single target hitting boss and you're putting this somewhere in your rotation where it's you're like eating up one of the big like single target heals and your tank dies because of that, just take it's not even worth messing with it probably. Just take it out and run the regular build. By the way, this should be like this. Okay, so Life Tap. You're gonna get 3 energy, and that means boom, you're gonna instantly cast Soul Seal, which is really good. This means you can time your Soul Seal with an early call to arms or Let's Charge by your warrior to give you extra attack on it. And then you're going to hit him with Soul Twins, which, if the target has a Soul Seal, which it will because we used it, it adds a bonus sub Soul Seal, which is deals the same amount of damage with the Soul Twins over 6 seconds. That's going to be really strong. And then lastly, you're going to hit Soul Wave to refresh the Soul Seal. So this is the build I'll probably want to use the most often. I think it rotates faster than all the other builds. For sure it does. This means you're stacking Soul Seals faster. Also, Life Tap is just going to be that for everything. Think about Life Tap as a one cost plus energy. Means that as long as your other three skills are really strong, you're going to get to use them more. So I think it works well in almost every case as long as you work it in with your team's abilities. So we're going to go to clatter build. I don't think there's too much to talk about for clatter build. I see a lot of people going the jaw, like you'll see basic is going giant jaw. It's good. I know it's probably the best late game build, and the reason for that is because the legendary, this guy right here, this is a really strong ability, and you need 3-star. But at legendary, he's like this is his skill, right? So this is the best DPS legendary card. So I see a lot of people building giant jaw because. That they're planning on building Spinosaurus to give 1800 attack to everybody, which is a good buff. But early on, I'm actually not convinced on Giant Jaw, but Basic's probably like planning for the future. I do think that Sharp Claw is still better. Sharp Claw is super good early. Everyone should be running it. He is right. I think Planes is going to be really strong early. And then if he can get crit, that's 600 crit early on. So I'm mostly talking early game. I'll be making new guides for the late game. So don't like if you're already at late game, which you probably don't need my help by watching this video, but for now I'm trying to give people advice on early game stuff. Sorry. Let's go ahead and look. I would recommend maybe flying if you can't get claw. It's okay. I'm not a big fan of it. But definitely Sharp Claw is the best. 30 HP and 30 attack for only 3 pieces. I know it doesn't scale well because you can only use 3 of them, but early on, 3 is still a lot of pieces. So, as you transition to maybe like 6 or 7 slots, I could see the giant jaw getting better. Let's see what else. Impale is okay. I do prefer the planes. So. Oh, and pick up one of these if you can. This is actually a big buff. And this is why I think Giant Jaw is going to be better, because you'll use this guy and he'll give you this this like ability here. When you crit, it adds more. So I know that late game for sure Giant Jaw is going to be really common, because look at all these cards that have it. Like, this is really big too. This is a huge damage buff. Yep. And there's this guy again. So anyway, guys, thanks for watching this video. I covered just about all the basics again. If you no pun intended, I was on basics account. If you are interested in joining the clan, join the Discord. We're about to make a clan in 3 days. So as soon as you can join that, make sure you select your role for Ulala and let us know you're interested in joining. And let me know if this video helped. Did I miss anything? I can, if you have any questions, like if I didn't cover something, like ask in the comments. I will answer for sure. I'll like write back to you. So, see you guys later. Thank you.